In fact, media education started to be put in practice, so to say, not very long ago. It was, in fact, the first real event, I would say, happened in 1982 with what we called the famous, really famous, and still up to date, Grunwald Declaration. It was an international meeting organized by UNESCO in Germany, Grunwald, and they adopted a declaration which in fact reviewed all the problems and challenges which existed in the global world, with all the challenges in the field of media, in the field of citizenry, how to involve people's participation in societies and social groups. And then there was a series of events, a series of meetings, international conferences and so on and so forth, but mostly in Europe. Why in Europe? Because Europe is a bit more developed, to be objective, than other countries. When I say Europe, it is also Canada and some other countries like Australia, Japan, Singapore, but again, relatively developed countries which don't have major social problems and so on and so forth. So after having solved a number of priorities for these societies, they could deal with media education, which unfortunately many consider as a secondary challenge. Okay? So, but at about 5 years ago, I would say, UNESCO became extremely active in this field. And not only active by organizing different conferences and meetings, but active in a much more pragmatic way, trying to encourage others, but also to be involved in the development of practical tools needed for media and information literacy. Already the notion of media and information literacy. Why media and information literacy? Because before, for example, in Europe and even now, the European Commission speaks exclusively of media literacy. Though they do include information literacy as well. They speak of media literacy or media literacy education and digital literacy. But what about, for example, computer literacy? What about internet literacy? What about broadcasting literacy? What about freedom of expression literacy? All these literacies we taught in UNESCO and we could implement it. We wanted to bring together. Because, of course, with all the differences and nuances, but still it is the same, grosso modo. No, totally the same. People should understand what is communication, how to communicate, how to decode messages. Because even if we take traditional media is not always reliable. It depends on the party, it depends on the funds they receive from. Even for public media, it depends on how it is organized, to what extent they are independent from different censorship and so on and so forth, to what extent self-censorship exists in media, to what extent they are manipulated by facts, what is the editorial policy, would they publish all the facts, or they would select some facts, and then the information becomes distorted, because not all points of view are expressed, and so on and so forth. All this, so in fact, media and information literacy, it's like one century ago, general literacy, when people were trying to learn how to write and to read, you know. Now in the world, which has developed, of course, tremendously, people should be media and information literate. Otherwise, they cannot be real citizens. They cannot participate in the public world. They cannot fight social exclusion. They cannot raise their voice against poverty, against hunger, against illiteracy. Still general illiteracy. We still have 1 billion people in the world illiterate. And I'm sure there are a lot of in Mexico illiterate people.
Yes.
You know that there is 1 billion people who have no access to radio nowadays in the world. 1 billion people with no access to radio. They may have their mobiles, but no radio. They can give a call, but they cannot listen to news, to entertainment, to educational programs and so forth. So it is extremely important.